Start your day with It's the Business. Here's Phil Dobby.
Well, today there are many and various new models for estate agents, like XP, for example, which is sort of like an Avon calling approach to estate agents, where estate agents not only sell houses, they also recruit other estate agents, and presumably they carry on doing that until everyone in the country virtually is an estate agent. But there are many other online models too. So does this all spell an end to those branded estate agents that we see on our high street?
What is more important, the sign above a high street estate agency office that stems back to 1880, or the people that you will actually deal with and their knowledge, their expertise, and above all, how they deal with you?
Russell Quirk joins me today to talk about the end of the high street estate agent, plus lockdown. We're on the way out.
Monday the 12th, I will be going to the pub myself and cautiously but irreversibly raising a pint of beer to my lips.
So all of a sudden, we are doing quite well, but will the world be split in two, those who've had the jab and those like the French, many of whom don't want it? And what are the economic consequences of a world split in two? It's Tuesday, the 6th of April, 2021. Good morning.
And now, it's the business, making sense of it all with Phil Dobby.
So talking of real estate, which we will be on the programme quite a bit today, car charging. We are all going to be driving electric cars in 10 years' time. How are we going to charge them up? We've got 40 million cars on the road currently. We've spoken about this before on the podcast. The numbers just don't stack up. 35,000 public charge points, 40 million cars. That is one charge point for every 1,150 cars. So if you imagine we wanted to charge them up twice a week and it takes half an hour, so that's an hour week, that's 40 million hours a week. And those charge points, if they were at 100% capacity, even if you had people getting up at 2 in the morning to go and use a slot, then we would only reach 4 and a bit million hours. So we need at least 10 times as many charge points before we are going to be ready for this electric car revolution. Now, I did say before, we're not hearing the government talk about this. They're talking about getting rid of petrol cars. They're not talking about how we're going to make way for electric cars to replace those petrol cars. So obviously, we need charge points in our homes. And hanging a power cord out the window, have you seen this? They've got it next door. They hang it out the window or through the door. It isn't very elegant, or you can push it through the letterbox. So next time you've got an electrician round to do something, get them to install a power point near where your car is going to be. Even if you don't have an electric car, it can only add to your house value, can't it? Because soon we are all going to want charge points where we can charge our electric cars up. And look, house prices are going to keep going up anyway, aren't they? With or without your charge point. Actually, they'll probably go down if you haven't got a charge point. So it's a small investment. But we saw a 7.5% annual increase up to January this year in house prices in the UK. A little less in London, but 12% in the northwest of England. All those people heading up north from London because it's cheaper without realising just how much it rains in the northwest. They'll be back. They'll be back soon. Just you wait. The Telegraph over the weekend was looking at the best commuter villages where you can buy something on average for less than £500,000. Cranley in the Surrey Hills is one of them. And, you know, you can use the money that you've saved to send the kids to Cranley Private School, one of the best in the country, I think. Woburn in Buckinghamshire, 23 minutes drive into, train journey into Marylebone. 23 minutes, that's pretty good, isn't it? And you can buy something there for less than £500,000. Nice bit. I was in Marylebone around there. Went to Regent's Park yesterday. Beautiful, even though it was freezing cold yesterday. Just how nice is Regent Park with all those grand buildings around the outside of it? I haven't been to London for a year, and you think, you know, sometimes you forget the good parts. You just remember the grimy, dirty parts of London. But then you go to the parks. They are magnificent. And I love this article, just back to that this comment, I should say, in that Telegraph article. Roger Hunt, who is very concerned about people moving to these villages who have disposable income from not spending quite as much in London, and they're going to use it to buy recreational drugs in once idyllic rural communities, he says. Yeah, I don't know, is that going to be a problem? If you're taking recreational drugs, you're not going to change these idyllic villages because you'll just be stuck in your living room smoking, won't you? I guess you've got to buy it from somebody. So you're going to have people on street corners. So he says, can we just put a ban on single childless under 40s moving into a rural area from a London address? He says, well, do you know what? I think we probably can now because, you know, the government is doing all sorts. You know, they're banning this and that. Who you can meet with, when you can meet them, how long you can meet them for, where you've got to wear a mask. So why not tell us where we can live as well? They're controlling every other aspect of our life. I'm not making a comment. I'm just saying that's the way it's going. We just got to make sure it doesn't go on forever. So bit by bit, we are coming out of lockdown with the next step next Monday.
Reopening shops, gyms, zoos, holiday campsites, personal care services like hairdressers, and of course, beer gardens and outdoor hospitality of all kinds. And on Monday the 12th, I will be going to the pub myself and cautiously but irreversibly raising a pint of beer to my lips.
Well, he's going to be lucky. I guess you can pull some strings if you're the Prime Minister, but around where I live, getting a seat at the table in any of the pubs or the cafes, the tables outside, they are booked for weeks ahead. So I'll be celebrating by going for a swim. Booking a lane at the local swimming pool wasn't a problem at all, but trying to get somewhere to get a drink, it's completely impossible. But and obviously Boris is going to be in the pub, not in the pool, even though he did promise that he was going to go on a bit of a health kick. What happened to that? Doesn't seem to be working, does it? Another promise from Boris that hasn't come quite to fruition. But look, the vaccine rollout working very well for him. We're well ahead in terms of the numbers, and he is very well ahead in the polls now. It's just over a year since Keir Starmer got the gig as head of the Labour Party. Net favourability scores from YouGov, the latest ones, has Keir Starmer minus 11. Oh dear. Boris Johnson minus 1. Still a negative. Actually, Boris has been a negative net favourability score all the way through. So there's more people don't like him than like him. But minus 1 means, getting borderline now. Keir Starmer minus 11. But until the end of January, Keir Starmer was actually in positive territory. But obviously the vaccines have saved the day for Boris. And Keir, well, he's just not that interesting, is he? If we're being honest. And the latest opinion polls now have the Conservatives on 44%. They would gain 10 extra seats now if there was an election. And Labour would lose 12. They would lose 12 less seats than Jeremy Corbyn managed. That's saying something, isn't it? So Boris doing well. 48% of the population now vaccinated. Over 8% have had two jabs. In the US, a third of the population vaccinated. And really positive economic data. There's just so much enthusiasm over there now. The share market reaching new highs over the weekend. I say over the weekend because the equity markets, the share markets were open on Monday. The S&P 500 has broken the 4,000 mark for the first time. The Dow also at a record high. They have what are called the services PMIs. These are purchasing managers index. So this is people who buy stuff for companies as part of the supply chain in the services industry. And there's a similar one for manufacturing, also very high. The services one was at 63.7 in March, up from 55.3 the month before. That is the highest ever. So all you need to know is all the economic indicators in the United States are looking very positive, and they are going gangbusters on the share market as well. How long it'll last for? Because it does seem very high to me. Can't keep on going up, particularly when the economy has been so depressed. But looking at a different story in Europe, it's going to be interesting to see how the US and the UK does versus Europe. Because look, in France, just 14% vaccinated. Half the population doesn't want the jab in France, so they're not going to reach herd immunity. Infections up to nearly 40,000 a day on average over the last 7 days. They reached 61,000 on Sunday. It's second highest day ever since the pandemic began. And it has political consequences because Marine Le Pen is now on a par with Emmanuel Macron in the opinion polls for the next president. So you can see how this is shifting politics towards the right. So will they show significant weakness in their economy? Well, we may find out today because the IMF, the International Monetary Fund, is releasing its updated forecast in the World Economic Outlook later today. This is the first one since last autumn. And you'd assume that they're going to upgrade the numbers because things have recovered faster than anyone had expected, particularly for the US, perhaps also for the UK. And perhaps they're going to downgrade them for Europe a little bit. We shall find out later on today. Now, let's talk about real estate agents. So is there a future for bricks and mortar high street real estate agents? That's the question. Because I have to say, I've been constantly amazed, not just in this country, but all around the world, how real estate agents seem to occupy pretty expensive real estate themselves. And I suppose that is because they want to get the shop windows in heavy traffic areas. So when you're out doing your Saturday shop, whenever we get back to doing that, you might, you know, impulsively buy a house. I guess that's the, is that the reasoning behind it? So will we continue? I don't think that works that way, does it? So maybe, you know, maybe they don't need to be where they are. So will we continue to see the model move out of the high street and online? Well, let's talk to our regular real estate commentator on It's the Business, the guy who actually set up eMove, one of the first and one of the biggest online real estate companies. Russell Quirk is with me. So is it sustainable, Russell, for real estate agents to keep their offices in the high street, or do you think they will all eventually disappear?
Yeah, hi, Phil, and thanks for having me back on again. I think it is probably unsustainable on the basis that we seem to be the only nation in the world that hinges its business model on old-style retail premises. The original high street model that, I mean, I grew up with, you know, my grandfather was an estate agent and my father was an estate agent. I kind of had no choice, I suppose, but to kind of be forced into the profession. But it was before the days of the internet and before the days of Rightmove and Zoopla and so on and so on. So I think, you know, there was the visibility necessity of high street branches. But the downside of that, apart from, as you rightly say, the kind of footprint costs, the premises costs of rent and rates and all the staff and the photocopier leases and so on, there's also now, I think, the disadvantage from the consumer's point of view that what UK estate agency has become is a lot of kind of high street brands rather than the dominance of the people within those businesses. And again, let me just explain what I mean by that. So, you know, brands obviously are important. I think that we can talk about that all day long in terms of how important it is to have a brand, and that brand represents something that's bona fide, you know, whether it's quality, service, value, whatever it might be. But I think what's happening in estate agency is the old-fashioned brands, let's take Foxtons or Bairstow Eaves that many people will know, or Connells or Hunters, for instance, they are all brands that built their reputations 50, 80, sometimes even 100 years ago. And of course, things have changed a bit since then. But what people in the UK kind of forget, because I think of the dominance of the high street estate agency sign, they forget the people behind agency. And if there's one industry that is people dominated and should be, given the length of time it takes to list a home, get it sold, get it through the whole conveyancing process, you know, 6 months generally now, we forget the importance of the people behind the brand. So I guess, as we'll come on to, that then, I think, provides an opportunity for a new model.
So, because with that people, those people equal trust, don't they? That's the thing. Because you are buying a house or you're selling a house. You're either going to receive a great deal of money, but more importantly, you're going to part with a great deal of money. And, you know, real estate agents, I hate to tell you this, Russell, but they don't necessarily have a great reputation, because sometimes they're not, they can be a little bit economical with the truth.
No, I've never heard that.
Well, maybe it's just my experience, but we want to look someone in the eye, don't we? We want to say, are you sure about that? And, you know, there's a bit of noise coming from the road. Is that normal? Or, you know, how good is the school around the corner? Sometimes people will say anything to get a sale. So if you've got a brand, if you've got a big brand and you've got the right people sitting behind it, then at least you know that if people keep on lying, that's going to damage, however old that brand is, if they consistently do it, it's going to damage the reputation of that brand. So I quite like brands.
Yeah. Well, yeah, no. So, as I say, brand is important, but you can't just have a brand without backup, I guess is what I'm saying. So what is more important, the sign above a high street estate agency office that stems back to 1880, or the people that you will actually deal with and their knowledge, their expertise, and above all, how they deal with you? You know, now, to your point about estate agents not having a great reputation, funny enough, I've just seen another survey. There was, I think it was Yes Home Buyers or somebody just done another survey that yet again puts estate agents at the bottom of the pile, down there with kind of tabloid journalists and collected traffic wardens. So,
like the way you put tabloid.
Rather than the broadsheet journalists.
So what you're saying is you're down there, so I'm not. That's what you're saying.
Yeah. Yeah, other journalists are a bastion of integrity, of course. I just think it's true that the perception is warranted, actually, in a lot of instances in terms of the estate agency profession. And here's the thing, and this might shock you to hear this, but do you know the reason why estate agents are generally pretty terrible in the UK? There is, in my view, a reason, and that reason is, wait for it, they're not paid enough. Now, you might recoil in horror, Phil, and say, well, what are you talking about? Last time I sold a house, I paid £6,000 in estate agency fees. I don't mean the fee, because actually the UK estate agency fees in percentage terms are amongst the lowest in the world. I mean, in the US, you'll pay 6%, Portugal 6%. I think the highest I saw somewhere, wherever it was, 8%. Some countries charge as a kind of matter of course. So we're charging in the UK an average of about 1.25% to 1.5%. I don't mean the amount that the business takes, the amount that you pay to the company. I mean the amount that individual takes. So typically, if you work at a Bairstow Weaves in Aylesbury, let's just pick them out for no other reason that it's the first location that springs to mind. The negotiator there will be on a £10,000 to £15,000 basic, and he will take about 5% of that 1.25%. So on a £3,000 commission, he's on about 150 quid, which is not that much incentive to look after a client from start to finish. Whereas...
And he's got to buy some very nice suits as well.
Oh, and they have to be and they have to be shiny, of course. So is it any wonder that the service that that person delivers is perhaps below par, as opposed to, you know, if you watch these brilliant real estate TV programs, I don't know if you watch them, you know, Million Dollar Real Estate New York and... Selling Sunset, fantastic programs. And you see that, you know, the girl or the guy ends up earning a $25,000 commission and they earn half of it, you know, personally. Well, they are completely obligated to make sure they look after the client. And that's why in the US and Australia, for instance, estate agency is seen as a decent profession. And in the UK, it's seen as the sort of thing that you do if you can't do anything else.
Yeah. Well, there is a bit of that, isn't there? But the, if everything goes wrong, at least I can become a real estate agent. I'm sure, you know, and no disrespect, but I'm sure a lot of people think that. But, I mean, if you were to give high commissions to people, then you'd run the danger that you've got people who are in it for a quick quid. And they really wouldn't care what they did. They'd get in and then bail out again and run before, you know, all the damage is realised. There's that danger. Because then, you know, again, you know, you're challenging that reputation thing, which is established over a long period of time.
Well, maybe. But this is where also high street estate agency offices, in my opinion, don't work, apart from the reasons that we just rehearsed, is because they rely on people just wandering in or calling up, kind of blind, really, and hoping that the service they get from that agent is okay. However, in other markets and other countries, the way it tends to work is that most agents get their business through recommendations and referrals. You're only going to get a recommendation or a referral if you're good at what you do. So this again, is a reason why I think we need to move away from the high street model. And the model, as I'm sure you want to talk about, like EXP and Keller Williams, which, you know, I'll declare an interest. I have a shareholding in a Keller Williams franchise. Those businesses focus specifically on the agent and allow the agent to earn more, but they insist that the agent is kind of, you know, a little bit different to a conventional high street agent.
Okay, so I get your point that the balance needs to shift from the company to the individual, and then you might get better people in the industry doing better jobs. Because the industry, I'm looking at some figures from Halliday's, the industry analysis for the sector. They say the most profitable 650 or so companies earned an average profit margin of 8.6%, which is a lot. Yeah. I mean, that would be good in any industry based on a percentage of something you're actually manufacturing. But when it's based on the price of houses that, you know, are just it's turnover that is just passing through your hands, you know, the real estate agents are selling something they haven't created. So for every $1 million home, in that example, they're earning £86,000. Yeah. But your point is that is going to the company, not to the individual. And the individual's earning a very small slice of that.
95% of it is going to the company that then goes on the unnecessary, in my opinion, overheads of the branch office and all the other bits and pieces around head offices and green minis with numbers on the side and so on and so forth. Yes, it's not going on the individual. And it's the individual that drives the service that the customer receives.
Okay, so there are other companies around. You mentioned XP, which is sort of like the latest reincarnation of an online agency, isn't it? It's a US company. It's listed on the NASDAQ. They're making inroads here as well. So what's different about them? How do they differ, for example, from the vision that you had with eMove?
Yeah, so this is where we have to geek out for a couple of minutes.
Oh,
so
good.
So you've got traditional agents that, as we've said, high street premises, and they charge a percentage on completion. So you generally pay nothing if your property does not sell. Mm. The business that I started, which was eMove, which probably people know the sector better now by bigger businesses like Purple Bricks, for instance, which is a listed business, does about 40,000 transactions a year. The advent of those businesses was where you would pay a much smaller fee, and a fixed fee actually, rather than a percentage, but it would be paid or committed to upfront whether you sold or not. So that then becomes a bit of a coin toss. So if you sell your home and you have a reasonable experience, you've paid less. But actually the data shows that about 50% of homes listed with online agents do not sell. Mm. So therefore, 50% of people waste their £1,000. So the saving is a kind of matter of conjecture, shall we say. So that's the difference between traditional agents and so-called online agents. So online agents are as a kind of upfront fixed fee. But the new breed of agents like Keller Williams, EXP, and there's a whole bunch of smaller ones. And, you know, I suppose I should mention some of them just for kind of good measure, like Agent and Home, like You Home, like Fine and Country, Hortons, for instance. They now are working a proposition that is about taking a percentage fee on completion. So it's a success fee, a contingency fee. But the majority of that fee, generally between 60 and 70%, goes to the agent, not necessarily to the company. So the company take a bit, and that pays for Rightmove and some compliance and technology and so on. But the agent doing the work takes the majority of the fee, but again, only on success. So that's the difference. And yes, in the US, that's the way it's kind of always been. So, you know, you've got big businesses apart from Keller Williams and EXP, like Coldwell Banker, like Berkshire Hathaway. The big business that I'm sure you'll be doing something on soon because they're about to IPO is Compass. Mm-hmm. Compass is a real estate business in the US that uses exactly that model. It's only about 5 years old, and it's rumored to be listing on the New York Stock Exchange very soon with a valuation of perhaps $10 billion.
Right. So I'm the agent. Yeah. I'm the agent, though, and I do all the work on this. So I do all the work trying to get a sale over the line, and that sale doesn't happen. I don't get anything in that model, do I? Whereas in the traditional world, I'd at least get my basic pay to try and see me through. So you've got to be good. So you've got to be good to survive.
Well, you have, but the disparity is. Let's say you're an average agent of average ability, working for a high street estate agency business. You with your basic and your commission, you might take home. And of course, it's territory dependent. You know, London agents in a good market will earn more than someone in County Durham, of course. But let's say that's typically £30,000 to £40,000 a year as a salary. So look, it's okay, but it's not. You know, it's not a lottery win. Whereas some
you're not
of the
be able
agents,
to afford to buy a house with it.
Well, unless it's in County
Durham. That's the irony.
Unless it's in County Durham. So, but the guys, I mean, I won't mention any names, but I happen to know several individuals at EXP and Keller Williams that will easily bank for themselves net over £100,000 this year. They will do that. They're already on target to do that. And yes, they've got a graft. They're much more 24/7. They have to roll with the punches because, yes, let's say a third of the business that they do doesn't actually come to fruition because buyers pull out, sellers pull out, and so on. But the upshot is the net is that they do much better, but they are standing on their own 2 feet. So they're paying for their own car, their own phone,
right,
et cetera.
So you've got all of those expenses. So really it's like they are independent agents, but they've just got a bit of support, haven't they? I mean, they've got the marketing behind them, and they've got the app behind them, they've got a bit of online training and all that sort of stuff so they have someone helping them but they are independent business people in effect, which is, you know, the sort of like the gig, almost like the gig economy approach, isn't it? What I don't like about XP, though, is this idea that I also will recruit other agents. Now, I guess there's nothing wrong in principle with the idea that, you know, if it's good for you, try and get other people on board. But then you're going to get a cut of their commissions as well, which is, I know it's not exactly like pyramid selling, but it's exactly like Avon used to be, isn't it? Where you have party planners who then get, you know, if you don't sell anything at the party, I'm sure you used to be an Avon lady, didn't you, Russell, in the day? I know what goes on in Essex. So so you get, you know, if you don't manage to flog anything, at least you get a few other people recruited, and then you get either money for recruiting them, or you get a cut on their earnings. And I don't know, is there anything fundamentally wrong with that?
I think that there's a fine line, and I think if you're business is predicated around recruiting agents simply to recruit other agents that then pay a fee that agent gets regardless of the second agent earning well, then that would, I think, be deemed by some as suspicious. If it is, as I understand it, with EXP and Keller Williams and others, if it's simply a case of, look, the agent comes in, they pay a small monthly fee for, you know, admin and so on, but then they earn on the basis of them only generally paying out if they themselves have earned a big gross commission and they keep the majority of it, then that I think is fine, proper and acceptable. I think the suspicious pyramid schemes of years ago were those where you would be bought in and immediately asked to buy a load of stock. So, you know, buy a load of whatever, Amway or, you know, health tablets for $5,000. And then the agent that recruited you ends up with 2,500 of that 5,000. And that of course, is
yeah,
unethical.
Buying forward the stock, absolutely. So this
but
is,
that's not
this
what,
isn't
that's
as bad
not what
as
this
that.
Is.
No. Yeah,
no,
for
no,
sure.
No. Because so, people are only earning if they're selling houses and everybody wins.
Yeah. So I'm surprised that how little most real estate agents are earning from what you're saying. Because I looked at those Halliday's figures and thinking, well, gee, there's good margins in this business. And we know the numbers are going up. What, we had 1 million houses sold last year, something like that. We know the prices are going up as you'd forecast, and you know, and I'd agreed with you, they're going to continue, aren't they? Because it's happening all over the world. But yeah, what do you reckon? There's a lot on just $25,000 a year, something like that.
Well, yeah, there's lots, because and I guess there's a number of issues that give rise to that. I mean, first of all, there's something like 20,000 estate agency branches in the country. So, you know, we'll all attest to the fact that our high street has got lots and lots of them. And actually, the amount of estate agencies in the high street has not reduced in line with other retail decline. So we certainly haven't seen estate agencies reduce in number like we have department stores or clothes shops or shoe shops. They've stayed pretty static. And that's because, to your point earlier, they're doing a very small amount of business per branch. So the typical estate agency branch in the country here only does about 4 deals a month. But of course, they're earning a percentage of a growing commodity value. So to your point, if house prices go up 6% per annum, like they did in the UK last year, then if your percentage fee stays the same, your revenue increases by 6%. That's not bad. There's not many businesses doing that. But yes, the majority, though, is going on overheads, rent rates and so on. And then look, there are some businesses, and look, this is all public stuff, what I'm about to say, so there's no contention here. You know, the likes of Connell's estate agents, who are one of the largest and private entity estate agencies in the country, their profits hover between £50 and £70 million per annum. You know, Foxton's listed business, I mean, they were making upwards of £100 million per annum, and they're not now. Countrywide, you know, that was a £1 billion business making, again, you know, hundreds of millions of pounds profit per annum. Not now. In fact, they've just been taken over by Connell. So there's a real kind of mishmash of different performances from estate agency businesses. And, you know, some do well, some don't. But fundamentally, actually, the people that do really well out of UK estate agency are landlords, local authorities from rates, photocopier salesmen and mini salesmen, because that's where the majority of the overhead is in high street estate agencies.
Yeah, absolutely. And it does make sense that they disappear and perhaps replaced by an apartment, for example, could use that space up more effectively. Look, just before we go, I sold an apartment myself once, by the way. I looked at the agency fees and thought, well, you know what? I mean, what is it? An estate agent turns up, looks nice. I was younger in those days, so perhaps I'd be more convincing as a salesperson. You know, you let someone in, you know, you've got to have the keys, let someone in, give them some of the sales patter. You've got to do that a few times and then hopefully you sell it at the end of the day. And I saved on the agency commission, but I tell you, it was a rocky road because the nearby real estate agent nicked the sign out the front of the building. And I know it was them because I went and found it in the garbage at the back of their office. So that was
tricks.
All fun and games.
Dirty tricks. I'm sure that never normally happens amongst
that would be a
estate
one-off.
Agency fraternity.
Do many people do that, though, actually try and do it themselves?
A very small number. The last data I saw on that was that something less than 5% of people will try and sell their home on their own. Because, of course, you can't get onto Rightmove and Zoopla unless you're an agent. So a lot of people assume that they'll just sell themselves and go onto Rightmove. Rightmove will not accept a listing unless it's from a bona fide agent. So you're then restricted either to social media, which will have kind of, you know, limited appeal, or potentially to, you know, a Gumtree or an eBay.
So that's the difference. I managed to get on the apps. So,
you could, great. But the problem is, as a seller, even if you could get on there on your own, it's all well and good saving the money. But the problem then is a buyer is going to come along and say, well, look, who do I want to deal with? Do I want to deal with a kind of green seller directly, or do I want to deal with a bona fide agent that actually is going to kind of provide me some advice and comfort and so on?
Oh, look, I absolutely wouldn't recommend it to anyone. And who knows, I might have sold it cheap, you know, I might have, because it didn't go to auction like most, this is in Australia, most houses go to auction. I just sold it, not at auction. So, you know, the auction process is something we could talk about another day, because I think it works so much more effectively than the way we do it here. But a conversation for another day. Great to talk, Russell. We've spoken enough, I think, for today. I'll catch you again soon. Thanks.
Thanks for having me.
Look, and there is only one story in the newspapers today. It's all about that press conference yesterday. We knew we were heading towards the easing of lockdown next week, but it was all confirmed, of course. We're open Monday, says the Mirror. Lockdown easing confirmed. A similar story on the front page of the Daily Express. Cheers, we're opening for business. PM hopeful of foreign holidays by next month, says the Times. Also, no end in sight. A different tack taken by the Daily Telegraph. No end in sight as Johnson says normal is some way off. Johnson throws foreign holiday plans into doubt in the Independent. Johnson pledges return to a semblance of normality in the Guardian. Book your table now, says the Metro, and carry on camping. 500 pop-up holiday sites to meet astronomical staycation demand. That's what they're saying in the Daily Star. Just stay in the back garden. If you've got a back garden, just stay in the back garden. Cornwall, there's going to be traffic jams. Get in the queue now for Cornwall, because it's probably started already. And then the FT covering this idea of COVID passports, which is something else Boris Johnson was talking about. And in fact, everyone's been talking about, haven't they, the last few days, whether you will be able to travel overseas with a COVID passport and whether that's a good idea or not. Johnson set for clash with Tories after backing COVID passports. Watch that story. Occupy the news over the next few days. But that is it for today. Tomorrow, we're going to look at how the finance markets are responding to the economic recovery around the world and why, to understand it, you almost need to be a bond trader. Even if you're interested in buying and selling shares and nothing else, you really need to understand what's happening in the bond markets. Paul Kavanagh will explain all of that to us tomorrow morning. That's it for today. I'm Phil Dobby. Thanks for listening.
It's the Business with Phil Dobby. Listen online at itsthe.business or wherever good podcasts.